Lord, go to her home. Oh, no, as soon as I get plugged up, her home, I got one. I got the notes over there. When are we gonna do the vote, acknowledging the vote or whatever it's called?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow, we add that to the agenda. Well, I ain't ready yet.
Oh, okay.
I had to work in the store today and I got stuck in traffic trying to get here. First thing on our agenda for tonight is to go over the agenda for tomorrow night. Got three items on there. First is a resolution to declare 4052 Sherbourne Road a public nuisance. Grass needs to be cut. I've been cutting the front, but nobody's cutting the backyard. So we need to, anybody have any questions about that?
That was just my question, what's up with it?
The grass is higher than the fence.
Wow.
Yeah. And neighbors in Steve's district are complaining to me about it. And I haven't been able to do anything done lately. We put it on the abatement board last year. The inspector came out and saw that the grass was cut in the front yard because, as I said, I've been cutting that. But just look in the backyard so nothing ever happened, so it's still...
Does our ordinance cover that? I know, like Birmingham, for example, they only look at front yards. What does our ordinance say? I'm just curious.
It doesn't say front or back. It just says that if the weeds are higher than 12 inches at a home,
they are.
Then okay. It fits that description.
Okay. Second thing is Resolution 2018-R22, which implements 20 miles per hour speed on Old Grants Mill Road between Grants Mill Drive and Grants Mill Road.
That's just basically that whole road, right?
No. It's from the entrance to that subdivision up on top of the hill, over right behind
from Stone Ridge to the Grants Mill Road.
It's about, well, a quarter mile, maybe.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah,
maybe. Oh, I was thinking that was the road over by S&G.
No, this is behind
Hampton.
Gotcha.
Road that goes in between there that runs from...
It starts,
yeah, I got it.
It starts there,
okay.
At McDonald's and makes a loop.
I got it now. Okay.
Yeah, before they straighten it out, that's the way my school bus took me home.
Okay, gotcha. We've been having issues, or what?
There's a site distance problem there with the new business that is going in.
Okay.
There's apparently a hill right leading up to where the drive would be coming out.
Okay.
And the engineers determined that 20 miles an hour was okay, but 25 was too fast for the business.
If I'm not mistaken, it's one way from that at that particular part of the road, isn't it?
No, it's not.
Is it two ways there now? It was, okay.
Yeah, back in your day.
Yeah, it was just one way for a while.
It's just a very short narrow stretch, I mean, so 20 miles an hour, they shouldn't be going fast.
Well, you have to ask your question, Mayor, are they gonna address that? Put the stop sign coming down the hill instead of the yield sign, Nick?
It is.
Coming out of Stone Ridge?
Coming out of Stone Ridge, coming down the hill, that's where a lot of issues happening also, as in speed.
I mean, that can be addressed, but it'd be, that's separate from this issue.
Could we add that as part of,
We'd have to go to the.
Look at it, where's the frame?
That's a city deal, you would have to go through the police department.
There are steps you have to take to change the signage.
Because that's a lot of issues too, is coming down the hill, it's a yield.
Yeah, we looked at one over here on 16th Street, where they changed it from yield to stop sign. Really, in my opinion, it should be a yield sign, but it was too much of an asshole to have to do the hoops to change it, so we just left it as a stop sign in that case. But that can be looked at, it doesn't have anything to do with this particular item. Oh, this needs, yeah, and this also needs to be done as an ordinance change, so if you can adjust.
Need to be changed to an ordinance?
Okay.
So, it's gonna be ordinance 2018-24 or 2018-5?
It'd be 2018-7.
Dash seven?
Yes, ordinance 2018-07.
'07. All right, now, then that will change item number three to 2018-24?
Yes.
Okay.
Change running by one more time, please.
What's that?
As far as we'll change it to.
2018-7, ordinance 2018-07.
For which number?
For the business. The 20 miles per hour.
Item number two.
For number two. Then number three, we will just certify the results for the election, that'll be that will take the place of that resolution though. So we'll have three items instead of two.
I have three on.
We already got three.
Yeah.
We have one more.
Okay, it'll be four.
It'll be four.
It'll be four, I forgot that was ahead of the road.
You don't have the election one on here.
That's the one that we were gonna add, instead of doing it tomorrow in the morning, we'll just do it tomorrow afternoon.
So it'll be number four?
Yes.
So two will be a ordinance.
Four. And James, you can update this and send it back out to all the council members with the right numbers, can't you?
Yes.
So you're saying there needs to be a yield sign at Grantsville Drive?
Stop sign, stop my stop sign there.
So there's a yield currently, okay, gotcha.
Okay.
I'm not sure why that's a yield sign either.
Anybody have any questions about either of these four items?
I was going to, I know the two are related, if I could, I was gonna ask, what is the, who is EDG and what is Abington Summit Point?
What?
What is Abington Summit Point and EDG?
Abington Summit Point is the facility that's being built on Old Grantsville, Old Grantsville there, the 55 hour.
Okay, gotcha, understood.
And I'm not sure which other question was.
I think EDG was just the engineering firm that mentioned the 20 mile an hour sign, I believe.
Yeah.
Okay, cool, I'm good.
All right, now, item number three, 2018-R, now 24, approves the road agreement with Jefferson County. And I know we did not ever receive them, but from the county, but they gave them to us, they did a resolution to give them to us. Do we have to do a resolution, give them back? I know it's appropriate because.
You don't have to, but they're not gonna do any paving until.
Until we do, okay, right. Well, then we'll give it back to them.
So did they decide, I think originally the up in the air was if they were gonna take 16th back or not?
Yeah, what we came down to with this agreement, what this agreement covers is, there were several that they were willing to pass off on us, and that's why it took this long. And there's some, see some stuff floating around saying, well, why? I saw that Terry had a new copy of an email saying, from Joe Knight, saying, why, you know, why are y'all not paving some portion of the road on Queenstown? And he said, well, it's because we've been slower getting the Irondale agreement through. We've been slower intentionally because they wanted to put several roads off on us that we didn't accept, from their initial several offerings. What this covers, just so you all know, it covers what we think are the county roads as identified in, within the city. With the exception of, we agreed in this agreement to take 16th and the little part of Georgia Road there in exchange for them taking Belmont. Originally, we had kind of pushed for them taking Belmont anyway, but it is not technically a numbered county road. So that was the trade-off. That is the trade-off in this, is we agreed in conversation to say, okay, we would present to you all taking the one from the school there. I thought like that's a good trade for Belmont. Belmont has, you travel Belmont a lot. Belmont has, it's been more recently resurfaced, but it has issues. And there's just a number of issues on there. All of them have issues, but that's what we, that's the only swap.
I've got copies of information Joe Knight brought us and a copy of that email that he's talking about, if y'all wanna look at them.
Has much of anything else really changed from the information we saw?
No.
Okay.
It's essentially the same. He came in here that night, you know, and presented that and had taken, from our conversation, and had taken a couple more off from the county and put on us, and that's why I didn't say much during the meeting, but that's why we went back to the drawing board afterwards and had conversations about it and said, you know, put those back along, and we came down to just those two. Who's gonna take Belmont, who's gonna take 16, and a little stretch of Georgia Road.
Is it still gonna agree to do Grants Mill?
They've got Grants Mill from Old Leeds on out.
On out to the.
Not the new part.
To where?
Actually, the rest of Grants Mill, from what I understand, but I'm sorry, I probably misunderstood what you were asking. You're talking about the four lane.
The four lane, right.
Yeah, correct, yeah, that's still their project.
They're still gonna do that project?
Yep. Any idea when? And that was a trade-off between them and the state. I don't know what their trade-offs were, but.
State run the check, probably.
The state said, we will take over some of your projects.
That's
and
right.
Do this project.
That's right.
So this agreement right here is the old agreement?
That is, that's the new one there where it says draft.
Did this one go out to all the council?
Yeah.
Yes.
Were you here tonight, Joe Knight came and back to where?
That's not the new
copies for each of us.
No, the one with Joe Knight is the old one.
Yeah, no,
it's been updated.
This one you're getting tonight.
Yeah.
This is the new one.
Okay, see, I haven't seen that one. I'm looking at the old one then.
Did you send that to him, sir?
I didn't have to.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We don't have that.
We don't have the new one.
Okay, we'll make it come.
Wonder if I'm missing.
Okay.
No, we don't have it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, and then item number four will be resolution 2018 R25. Certify the election from last week.
We're basically just certifying what happened. I don't think there's really.
You just the phone number is.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Okay, well, I don't have a copy. This is every, all I've got. He didn't email it. Go pass it down so they can see what Joe wrote.
I'll wait.
I'll wait till the one we're actually talking about.
Well, it's Okay.
You know, but I'm just.
I'll make the copy. All right, next is the two hundred bicentennial committee for Irondale.
Mr. President, can we skip down, cause I gotta leave in like 20 minutes, and go to the SLAM contract and then the Jefferson County Board of Contract? Just that, dealing with parks and things like that.
Go down to number five?
Yeah, number four first.
Four, SLAM?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right, everybody got a copy of that contract?
Yes, sir.
All right, I've got a few questions myself, but y'all go ahead and then I'll, John, you got any questions you want?
I'm good with contracts, so y'all have any questions?
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess, the way I read it, it was really there was a 3-year contract, which is up for renewal, which is why we're talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
And in the first 2 years, he was supposed to spend $100K on the fields, but within the end of the third year, a total of $2,000 on the fields.
$200,000.
$200,000 total. It was a total of $2,000, correct? Or was it a total of $30,000?
$100,000 the first year and $200,000 by the end of the third year.
Okay, my bad. Do we feel that that money's been invested? I mean, I know loads of dirt costs a ton of money. So do we feel that that money's been put into the field?
I haven't seen anything that you've done, to be honest with you.
Haven't seen anything that you've done?
Not that I'm aware of.
I sent you some pictures, Ray.
I just got it, but I haven't had a chance to go into it yet.
Take a look at him real quick.
Okay, he has brought in dirt.
He's brought in, he's done a lot of, I'm not quite sure he's done $200,000 work. But he's done a lot of work over there.
Okay.
And here's the.
What was he gonna do with the fields? Is he gonna?
He was gonna try to get them up as best that he can. He's not the savior. John DeRue's not the savior. He came in, baseball guy, you know, agreement, not costing the city, after not costing the city any money. He just wanted to use the field. He has a program. He was working on youth baseball. He was gonna put some money into the field and try to get him up to par. The best he could. To get him up to par, it cost millions. $200,000 is a scratch of the surface. You know, so he's put some money into the field. He put some money. I'm not quite sure if it's $200,000.
He doesn't claim that he spent $200,000.
No, he doesn't claim. That's correct. Yeah. I think he's got it in now. He's got that email too, man. He doesn't claim to spend $200,000 at the field. You know, but he has put some work in.
David, let me ask you, you said it's set to expire. I'm looking at the date, I thought it was 2019. What date are you seeing?
Well, I saw the discrepancy in the years myself, and I made a note of it.
I saw some 15s and some 16s on there. One second.
Looks like it was executed in 2016.
Actually, 2016. So it's 2019.
I guess the proposal was drawn up in 15. That's probably where I'm getting 15 from.
It started out in 15.
Yeah.
Okay. But it wasn't executed until 16.
16.
Okay.
That's correct.
Fair enough. Yeah. So it's not necessarily up for renewal. I guess we're bringing this up so that it's.
Yeah.
Just trying to decide on whether we want to keep the contract rate, basically, right? Because it's got a 30-day out on it.
It has an out. I'm sure. I haven't heard this in a while.
It's 30 days.
It's a 30-day. This, I think, it's kind of the basic contract all of.
I guess there's been a lot of talk back and forth about how he was supposed to maintain the inside of the fences, we were supposed to maintain the outside of the fences. So I guess the real question is are we maintaining the outside of the fences?
No. I'm gonna say the city no, haven't done it, because he has put some work on those fields and they had a draining problem. For years, and it still has the draining problem with rocks and rain. Rocks will wash up on the field. So I'm going to say, no, they haven't lived up to it. The city hasn't lived up to it. I'm going to say the city haven't lived up to their part for 20 years now. I'm just going to be on record to say that. You know, it's not for us. I think we have neglected. I'm part of the city too, so I'm going to put me first. I think we have neglected those fields, and that's why they're in the shape they're in now. Now, this guy came in on goodwill, just wanna put some money in, try to get some, try to get them at least a couple fields up the best way you can. And I think he's done it. The big field still has a draining problem.
Yes.
The second, if you, if it, if you go out there probably today on that huge field, on shortstop, it's probably got, probably in underwater. It's probably underwater.
Aquifer there, isn't there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's probably underwater. So I'm gonna say, as me, we're part of the city, I'm gonna say, no, we haven't done our part.
So I would say that if we are going to keep the contract, then we need to say specifically what we are going to do to maintain, because there's a lot of vagary in that contract.
That's right. He's had a conversation with the mayor. He's met with the mayor a couple times, I think. I think, and I think y'all had a conversation. Yeah, I had a couple conversations, we talked. I'm not sure what that entailed. But he has come of goodwill and sit down with the mayor and Frank and talk about this contract.
Yeah, I'm happy to speak to him. I think, I didn't know him for years.
Yeah.
He's a nice guy.
He's a nice guy.
I think he has good intentions. I think it's a bad contract, and I don't say that to throw darts at anybody. I just think there's a lot of confusion about it. Because there's two parts to it. There's the contract and there's the proposal.
Right.
And the problem is not that, you know, someone presents you a proposal and then you develop a contract, but the problem then becomes is in the contract, it references parts of things out of the proposal, and so it gets convoluted as you go through there. So I think it's just not easy to understand. And so what happened, best I could tell, I met with him a year ago, and because I was reviewing all contracts at that time, of which his was one of them. And you know, there was confusion then. The city was, at that time, the city was cutting the fields. But that's not what the contract says. The contract says he maintains inside the field. So even though people were doing stuff, nobody really knew who was, it was really kind of unclear, not just to us, to the council, and to me, and the people here, but the staff that was actually working on it and him, there was confusion as to who was really going to be responsible for what. And so that's why I kept saying we need to look at this, and we need to clarify. We need to clarify, is it good times? What's it? I had a frank conversation with him. He's a good, as far as I can tell, great guy. You know, and I said, why do you want to do this? I mean, this puts a lot of burden on you, you know, and a lot of expense. You're talking about $200,000 of your own money to spend on that. I mean, I'd be running another way if it was me. I'd be saying, if you want to let me out, let me out, you know, and I'll give up my rights to it. But what the problem that it creates for us now is nobody really knows who's in charge. You know, he got some, we do some, somebody else got some. You got, you know, us having this discussion, you got them thinking, you got staff having to, do we cut the grass, do we cut it inside the field, or do we leave it up, you know, a foot high when it doesn't get cut? It's a reflection on us. There were several times I sent them over there to cut the grass, because even though I knew that it was not in the contract for us to do it, because it needed to be done. Last year on opening day, you know, the grass was 6, 8, 10, 12 inches high. We went over there and cut it because nobody else had cut it. It wasn't being the contract. It wasn't our job to do it, but we did it. So there's been that confusion. There's still that confusion. You know, there's the Armadale Youth Association trying to do baseball. There's John DeRule and Slam trying to do training. There's a dog park there. You know, there's all of that in there. And we don't know who's in charge. None of us really know who's in charge. And I think what John said is correct. It's. I don't think the city's lived up to its expectations. I wouldn't say that he necessarily has, and everybody may have their reasons why they haven't, but he may be not fully to his, but he's made an effort, city's made an effort. It just hasn't been good enough, I think, to satisfy any of us, including you all.
So are we saying that we need to write up a new contract to take the place of the existing one that's more specific? And I mean, is that what we're, is that what we're saying?
I think it's simplified.
Let me ask. I mean, this is a contract that our city attorney agreed that it was okay. So I can refer to her as the city attorney. and they approved it. Because we sent all of our contract through our attorneys to get it for approval before we decide on anything.
Well, we just said, I'm not sure what happened.
So I'm trying to, I'm trying to refer to her.
I was not involved in it. I've looked through our computers. I did find that Brandon was involved in it to a certain degree, and I've even found a draft that it looks like Brandon had put together. And what happened after this, I don't know, but Brandon had put together a draft that made a little more sense to me, and much more clearly designated manager responsibilities, city of Irondale responsibilities. It didn't try to incorporate by reference so much.
What was that ever?
But that was not what was signed and approved, so all I can say is I don't know how we got to this document.
And let me jump in there for just a second on that, because I think that's a valid point. We're finding, and Councilor Wilson asked to work on ordinance working on the cars. We got an ordinance where it was drafted, you know, and worked through, but was never approved. So there's a lot of those that we've talked about, I say maybe in the past, you know, have been talked about, even ordinance drafted, but for whatever reason, didn't quite make it over the hump to get voted on, to get approved. And so they're sitting out there, but never, no action on, which I think is why you were asking to revisit that. You know, this looks like one of those cases. I didn't, it's the first time I heard that, but if Brandon worked on that and drafted it and wrote it up, I can't sit here and tell you why it never was acted on, but it wasn't approved.
Mayor, that contract did go to, I mean, it did go to the attorneys in the law firm, because Brandon was our attorney at that time.
Right, I'm not saying that he was not involved, I'm just saying I can't speak.
Yes, I'm just saying, he was here at every council meeting, so he was here when the contract was adopted.
Brandon was at every council meeting?
Yes. And the thing that happened with Bobby Jones' contract, with the ordinance that they had for that, is they tried to approve it, but there were some neighborhoods that they wanted to exempt, and some neighborhoods didn't want to be exempt, and they were trying to figure out, well, are we going to exempt some, and if we exempt them, who's going to approve it? Is it the council? So by the time they got through going through all that.
Yeah, it was public pressure.
Right, they just decided that they were not going to do anything with that one. So that's what happened with those, because the contract was reviewed by the attorneys, and the reason that the other ordinance didn't go through is because by the time everybody kept going back and forth with each other, they just decided that they were not going to adopt it.
Yeah, and we thought, of course, the parking ordinance was a good ordinance, but we have a few council that, you know, in my neighborhood, we don't want parking on the grass.
Just didn't have the will.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? In my neighborhood, we don't want more parking on the grass. But we have sidewalks, and we have parking. But in some neighborhoods.
Yeah, no, I was just using that as an example to say that sometimes they don't make it through.
That's right, and then that was one of the parking laws.
I've got a subdivision in my district where they've got no alternative.
And we agreed to exempt that neighborhood because of that.
You've got one in your neighborhood that they have no alternative than what?
Parking in the driveway. Got every house has just park space for one car, and so they had to park on the street or park in the yard.
So anyway.
Let
me go back to Slam. So what you're saying, Mayor just mentioned, the one that you have in your hands now is more comfortable with, you think, that we should be going by?
Well, it's a different presentation. Mm-hmm. I found it when I was trying to get as much information about the history of this as I can. I hadn't tried to fine-tooth comb it to say whether it is right or not. It's just a different presentation.
But, I'm in agreement to make sure we're doing the right thing.
No, absolutely. I think if we're responsible for something, we need to know what we're responsible for. Correct. If he's responsible, he needs to know.
I'm good with that. So if you think that the one that you found is one, then let's take a look at it.
I think it was a place to start.
Yeah. Let's get John in here. Let's talk through and find out exactly what we need to do.
And John said he would like to be here.
He just had a big tied up today. Today's a bad day.
Okay.
So we'll find a day that he could be here.
Do it on the next work session if you want to.
Monday's a bad day. It's a bad day. Yeah, it's a bad day.
Tell him come on Tuesday. talk to him for hotel.
I think Tuesday would be a good day.
He said Mondays and Fridays were usually good, but just today he had something.
Okay.
I think that's, I'll check.
I can check it. I'll go back and check.
See about the 30th?
All right.
We'll look at that.
We'll move on.
Look at that, you see.
Yeah.
Back up.
He wants to talk about the education contract, board education also.
Oh, yeah, that's another.
All right.
And last night I talked last week, you want to talk about what you come up with that on that one?
Yeah, what I did on that was, I didn't do a big rework on the county board's proposal, but I did revise it some, just in a way that I think better protects the city, not to the detriment of the county board, it just more clearly defines who we would be, or who would potentially be using the Shades Valley Gym, such that it would come under our contract and therefore under our control and our responsibility. So, and James sent you a clean copy of the agreement as I revised it, I believe that's what you had sent out. And so that's my recommendation. Now, to my knowledge, this has not been considered by anybody at the county board yet, but if y'all want to go ahead and just move forward with considering this as early as tomorrow night, I don't know why you couldn't, just be aware that the county board has not seen, to my knowledge, has not seen this draft, and therefore may end up saying, well, we've got an issue with this word or that word, but we can perhaps kind of tweak it.
Do you have any track changes on here also?
Not on the copy that you have, but I can certainly get you, I can show you while we're here, or I can email it to you.
Just email.
Yeah, me email too.
Well, I've got a couple of questions on it. In section one, it talks about the insurance and who's going to be paying the insurance for the people in the gym, using the gym.
We talked about that last week. Last night, I talked about the last week. The insurance normally, let me give you a history. What normally happens? When we had a youth basketball league, the league off their own insurance, liability insurance.
Okay.
So we covered ourselves.
All right.
The city didn't cover that. We purchased liability insurance for kids that hurt or whatever, with the school was covered.
Uh-huh.
And that's how that happens. You have to purchase your own liability insurance. That's how that. But one thing we also talked about, and I think the contract we brought up last week, is that I think the contract says anybody can use it. And that's not what the contract, that's not what it should happen. It was only for youth basketball.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning that AAU team, travel team couldn't come in and use it under our contract. They could not come and use it. Now, if they wanted to use it, they didn't have to go through the board themselves, they have to go through the school themselves, have their own liability insurance, they have to have their own agreement as far as that concern.
Okay.
This was just strictly for Irondale youth basketball to use.
Well, and I didn't even specifically say Irondale youth basketball, but what I did say is that the agreement will only cover use by groups that we designate in writing to the school board. In other words, we tell them, here are the groups that are going to be using under this contract, here are the days, you know, they'll tell us availability days, and then through that process of actual communication, which is what was not at least reflected in the prior version, then it'll be clear if somebody's there using it, they either are or are not covered by this contract. Now the other piece is exactly what John said, that I'm strongly suggesting that y'all make sure that anyone that we do allow to use the facilities under this agreement, we have a separate agreement with them, and that's the agreement that would require them to have insurance and them to indemnify us, because we are having to agree to the extent allowed by law, indemnify the school board if anything happens. So what we want is somebody to indemnify us, and certainly the groups that are going to be the ones using it should be the ones to do that. So this is kind of the first half of the process, and the second half is having a separate agreement with these youth groups.
But it's not limited to just basketball.
No, it's not. It doesn't define that.
It's a governmental agreement, because Dr. Marsh said to me it could be something with the fire program, that they're there, you know, if they were doing some training or something.
Well, it talks about youth athletic programs, if we want to change that.
I need to send that to me, I didn't know, you know, verbalize that to me, so.
Yeah, just to talk about.
I'm honored, I'm not trying to expand it, I just said, he said.
Perhaps define it as a youth athletic program.
Leslie, can we look at section three termination?
Yes.
That first line there, I don't know if you left out a word or put something in there.
I did see that there's a two missing, notwithstanding anything in this agreement to the contrary.
Okay, yeah.
Yep, you're right.
All right, and then it talks about appropriation of funds otherwise necessary to allow the party to fulfill its future obligations here under. Now, which, is that talking about the city's funds or the basketball funds? It's on section three. Third and fourth line.
It said either party fails to approve appropriation of funds. That's just language that pretty much is in many of the governmental. But it applies to either party.
If either party doesn't fulfill their financial obligation, it terminates.
Well, what it is if either party doesn't approve appropriations sufficient to cover it, to cover any cost under this agreement. And there really isn't much cost under this agreement for the city, but we do agree in here to reimburse the school board for the cost of providing one board employee on site anytime the facilities are being used under this agreement. So that really is the only thing that would potentially come under that line.
I just didn't want to get stuck with a bill for several thousand dollars for something that we weren't responsible for.
The only thing that we're agreeing to pay out of pocket is that their one employee, except for that we are agreeing to indemnify them for any liability that they happen to incur as a result of the use of their facilities under this agreement. And that's, again, why it's vital for us to have a separate agreement.
For the insurance.
Yeah, to make whoever it is that we're going to allow to use Shades Valley High School under this agreement to have their own insurance with us being to pay, or us being, you know, us being insured, you know, for additional insurance.
That makes sense. I think.
That's the only thing I saw that made a question about.
I think even that could be changed, where that responsibility goes on over towards the people that are renting the facility.
Well.
And that's what happened. Again, I'm just talking youth basketball, that's the only people that ever use it. We paid that person. The city never paid that person.
And that would be great.
We raised the money to pay that, whoever that person was, known as one of the coaches, would be there to open up the gym and stay there. And we paid that person, the city.
You could put that.
Yeah.
That would need to be in that other contract.
I think that would be, in the one, you're talking about the separate contract, what you're talking about, okay.
But the county board, as best I can tell, is requiring that we agree to pay it, whether we find somebody else to agree to pay.
I mean, I think that's rightfully, I mean, I think that's.
Right.
We've always done that, so. The city has never paid that.
Okay.
Never paid that.
Anyone else have any questions or concerns about this contract? All right, let's move back up to item number two, the 200 bicentennial committee, Irondale.
I come bearing gifts.
Yes.
Is this formal, do I need to say chairperson, counselors, and mayor form?
Just say hey, y'all.
I was thinking, I was like, is this like the formal thing or not?
No, just say hey, y'all.
So anyway, I'll talk while I hand these out then. And so you can each get one. My name is Mary Allison Haney. I've lived in Irondale over 10 years, and I'm now chairperson of your Alabama Bicentennial Committee. For those of you, you're probably aware by now, it's been celebrated since 2017. It's a three-year recognition going through the territorial years up until our 200th birthday, which is on December 14th, 2019. There's a commission at the state level, and there's also a staff at the state level. Jay Lamar is the executive director of the Alabama Bicentennial Commission. And I run a statewide arts agency called the Alabama Folk Arts Association. And that has placed me at the state level world, meeting with all the other large agencies to help promote the bicentennial, encourage people to be active in it. And since I've lived in Irondale and been active here with the Arts Council and otherwise, I got together with Lynn Peace Marino, and then she gathered some other people, and we put together a grassroots committee to make sure that the city of Irondale is included in Alabama's bicentennial. So we've had a couple of meetings, and we decided during our conversation, one of the opportunities through this, which is a lot because it kind of places Irondale on the map and it gets you involved with other communities and counties all over the state of Alabama, is there's grant opportunities as well. And the next deadline is this Thursday, and they just recently announced all this. So we kind of operated really, really fast, and the Irondale Arts Council is going to be willing to serve as a fiscal agent for that. And our conversation and brainstorming about what we could do here in Irondale went from directly downtown, and and so we talked about all the different things that have been discussed for many years. I mean, about enhancing the downtown area and doing things with the pavilion down there and the viewing platform. And so that's where we kind of concluded with what we would like to do, and at least get the seed money and work with the city and other organizations throughout. I have the committee members listed on the second page, so you can tell there's the chambers involved and the fire department. And we concluded that we would have an Irondale Heritage Project would be the title, and it would include enhancing the railway pavilion, viewing pavilion with some historical interpretation, possibly some panels. And then we would also have an Irondale Heritage Day once we get some projects complete, but we wanted to definitely engage in some placemaking projects and any other public art or enhancements to the trestles that we could do that would create a sense of place here and bring everybody together and then celebrate Irondale's heritage and our contribution to the state's industrial history, specifically because of the railroads and the role Irondale has played in the industrial heritage of the state. So with all of that, what we have to do to apply is send in a resolution, and apparently y'all signed a resolution in 2015. Right, and they've done some changes to that and made it part of this process. And then we have to have our committee, and we have to have support of the city in awareness, you know, so that, and then from there, we'll take on the responsibilities of getting any kind of in-kind contributions or raising any further funds. But the communities are allowed to apply for just $2,500. It's $2,500, and the counties are $5,000. But, so anyway, that's what we were planning to do, and we hope all of you will be excited about that and be excited to have Irondale on the map along with everybody else around the state of Alabama. And look, I encourage you to go to their website too, because there's opportunities for schools on there, there's educational information, there's endorsements from the governor that you can do for various things, that has information on how communities can get involved and has instructions, and we're just following their instructions. I mean, that's the easiest thing to do. The resolution is straightforward. Same thing, people are signing all over the state. And that's about it. Do y'all have any questions?
What day are you planning on doing the Heritage Festival?
We were looking at October because there were a couple of dates in October where the city applied and organized, and then when it was finalized, it was in October of
1888, I think.
Yeah, I don't know the date of that off the top of my head right now. Yeah. But it would be kind of separate and unique and, you know, different and focus on the history and all this stuff. So,
thank you.
And if you want any goodies from Montgomery, we have lots of goodies from Montgomery, and you can always have as many as you want. So, and I don't know if I got something up there to use, so but we'll outline that here.
Good
they're real good about sending stuff if you have a meeting or anything, so. It's exciting. In my capacity, I'm serving four different communities, so, and I wanted to, have the support of the Alabama Folklife Association as well, because my organization and the folklorists at the state level have worked together to document railroad workers over the years and various musical traditions associated with the iron and steel industry. So I can lump this in to what I do, which makes it nice. And I was gonna write the grant application and help with any other submissions, like to the Alabama Humanities Foundation or the Arts Council, since we're a partner program to the Arts Council.
Is there anything we as a council need to do to help?
I think we were just gonna let you know all this is going on, so that if we receive the $2,500, we'll know in May. And then there's one other deadline after that, but we'll know pretty soon. This way you're aware of what we're doing, and I know you're working on some branding processes, and maybe, you know, if they're gateway projects or design projects, we can all coordinate together. And so if we do some panels downtown, when we look at the design or something, we can make sure everything has some consistency. And beyond that, just be aware so that when we come in and present about it and tell you what's going on and making progress along the way, we can keep you better engaged and informed and make sure the planning department, of course, will have to work real closely with them on that.
Okay. Just so I can be clear, I heard about the grant, which you just mentioned. But does the city, do we have any other financial obligation?
No. We're going to take on that responsibility, and then the Irondale Arts Council will serve as the fiscal agent. Okay. Since the committee doesn't have a thing, and it's anybody on the committee with any of their entities, you know, if they're affiliated with, can serve as a fiscal agent. I probably shouldn't, because I've got other grants going through my organization. They're statewide and through the National Endowment for the Arts, and so I can't do that for four towns. But anyway.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Next thing is pavement management plan, and Matt's not here.
Yeah, I'm saying, so I don't know if he got his dates mixed up, but he's supposed to be here for the work session, so I'll follow up with him tomorrow.
Okay, all right. And that leaves us with the road, Jefferson County Road Agreement, and we've already been over that at the council meeting. So does anybody have anything else we'll talk about or contribute?
I guess just for clarification, the one thing that we wound up taking was 16th, basically, right? Out of all that, going back to
the little part of Georgia Road.
Okay. Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. There's actually a list in that agreement, I think, of which one is the time we're going.
Anybody else like to say anything to the council or ask any questions?
Just to give a quick update, Place and I wish they're working on the ordinance that you may have mentioned earlier. That was kind of pending status earlier, so we're still kind of looking at it. I've made some amendments to it, and as soon as we kind of peruse it a little bit, we're going to get it to the council so you guys can put some eyes on it.
Which one was that?
The one about the parking.
Okay.
Yeah, about the parking ordinance.
All right.
And I also want to look at our noise ordinance also. You know, there's been some complaints about noise in the neighborhood, band playing in the garage and stuff like that. So we need to look at that also.
I think we adjusted it last year.
We just went over that. I want to say, I think the people that are probably doing it are probably just in violation of the ordinance.
Yeah, I got a copy of it here. So
what's the title?
Yeah, yelling, shouting. It's a 2016. Yeah, we kind of made an amendment about commercial lawn equipment.
We did.
Yeah. It was about commercial lawn equipment.
That was before you all got here.
No. Yeah, but I think we still have the council ordinance.
That was previous council. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the only one I remember.
Well, we had an exemption for public works, but, you know.
Yeah, that was the whole deal about people that was, lawn care companies were coming and cutting grass. But the rest of the ordinance hadn't been changed. I mean, it's pretty much the same.
Okay.
But that's been since this administration, because I was here.
It has.
Was there a gap or something that?
Well, it's, yes. I don't have my other phone, but I wrote some notes down, and I'll let you guys mention, I'll mention it to you.
When was it adopted, council?
2017. Don't have a date on it.
2016 or 17?
I'm sorry, it was 17.
Oh.
Here's the ordinance, right? I said 16, it was 17.
Oh, so that was last year?
Yes.
This was 18?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm flashing it, I found it.
Yeah.
Way back last year.
That's all that I have.
Mark?
Can I go off script for a second?
Uh-huh.
Okay. James, I know that you were looking into some information about top 20 companies as far as what their payroll is. Have you had a chance to gather any of that information? I know it's only been a few days since you were so nice to volunteer to gather that.
No, because when we talked, I think it was on Friday.
Yeah, it hasn't been very long.
Yeah, so I won't be back here until.
Okay, yeah, I saw your email. I won't be back until Tuesday. I was actually surprised to see.
Yes.
Okay. Well, what, I know I can't ask a city employee to do anything, but me and James had a conversation, and he was so nice enough to volunteer to see if he could come up with any payroll numbers for the top 20 employers in the city. I think it's time that we crack open the conversation about an occupational tax. So, good, bad, or indifferent. So.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll go back to what I said about that. I don't necessarily want to do occupational tax, but I wouldn't object to raising the car tax again. We did it about 4 years ago from 1 to 1.5. And Trustful and Birmingham both have 2%. And it would make a big dent into that deficit we got. I think it's around $6 million we're collecting now, somewhere around that. About 0.5% would be $1.5 million.
No, Councilman Beard, it's about half of that.
Yeah, I'm so sorry.
I wish it was, but yeah, it's
okay.
But it's
impossible.
Yeah, it's about half. It's about right. It's about $3 million of the $9 million we collect.
Okay. Well, it's still put a dent in.
So I hear you. You don't want to.
That'd be another $1 million. Yeah.
I hear you on that, you don't want to do that, but I'm going to tell you, you know, this council, I'm just going to speak bluntly here, this council is going to have some tough decisions to make, mm-hmm. and you may have to do some things you don't like to do, don't yeah. want to do. Occupational tax may be one of them, maybe not, maybe you got another source of income, but you also don't want to lay people off, and that's where you're going to be. You're going to be making some hard choices mm-hmm. very soon if you don't come up with a revenue source. You can't, I mean, we only got, at the beginning of this year, we only had $3 million in reserves. And before we ever started out the gate, we agreed as a council to dip into that by $700,000. Sam's left a $1.4 million hole. So you add that up, that doesn't leave a lot of reserve left. Less than a million, if I did the math right mm-hmm. in my head then. Mm-hmm. And so we can sit here all day, all night, every meeting and say, we don't want to, I wouldn't like to. I don't like occupational tax. I pay it though, and you pay it,
and you pay it.
Mm-hmm. Everyone up here, except for the city employees, pay it. So it may be a choice of laying some people off for doing occupational tax, or whatever tax it is. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you, a nickel and dime is not going to do it. You don't have to be real astute at math to add the numbers up and see where you end up. So.
Okay.
You know, even if the property tax had passed, I think you still have this question. I just think that had the property tax passed, I think a year from now, it would be much easier for you. Now it's going to be hard now, and it's going to be hard a year from now to make the budget balance, unless you have a reduction in workforce or you come up with a substantial source of revenue. That's where we are. The numbers don't lie. You're going to have a finance committee meeting?
Yeah, I definitely wanted to talk more about this on the 30th when we had the opportunity to. I know, James, thank you for sending out the reports through April. I haven't had a chance to really dive through it, but I know it's the good 6-month mark, and maybe there's some Mercedes money in there that I haven't had a chance to go through it yet. So I know one thing we're excited about is to maybe kind of see some of that money starting to trickle in, so just to give us an idea of what that might look like.
Yeah, if we...
It was disappointing, though.
The numbers are disappointing.
Yeah, well, I've seen them initially.
Okay.
And let me, I've already talked to the department heads.
Yeah.
I mean, you all know, you sent it back, sent the budget back to them in the fall, told me to take it back to them, and they cut the loan. They're cut with what they're doing. And I know we all want more services, we all want better services, but, you know, they're at the limit of what they can do, both in this building and outside this building. And I'm not in a position where I can expect, I have high expectations, but where I can expect them to do much more than what they're doing now. And I've already talked to the department heads and said, you need to start looking, because I don't know what the council's gonna do, but you need to start looking and say, if you have to cut five people, which five people are you gonna be cutting out of your department? If you have to cut two people, which two people are not gonna have a job, you know, or what service are we gonna eliminate completely that we're doing now? So, I mean, we are fast approaching that. I try to be careful during the tax referendum thing, not to try to scare people into it, let everybody have their vote and do their thing, and I think I was really fairly balanced in the presentation on that. But there's nothing up for a vote now. I mean, we're facing reality, and we gotta make hard decisions. You were elected to lead, and that's what you're gonna have to do.
Can we get a copy of the Mercedes contract? I believe we've got in there that we can't raise their sales tax for so many years, but we can raise it on the others if we need to.
15 years.
It was 15? Was it set at 1% or 1.5%?
It's at 1.5%, but you can't increase it for 15 years.
Yeah, I knew it was that clause was in the contract, but we can't raise it on the other dealership.
So we're basically, we would look at raising it on every other dealership other than Mercedes. Mm-hmm. I think perceptionally, that's, I don't like the way that looks.
Well, it doesn't look good, but may have to do it. You know, if we're gonna look at occupational tax, I'll look at that too.
I definitely would like to see the numbers on what that would look like. I'm not a big fan of occupational either. I remember when I transitioned from working to Irondale to Birmingham, I was like, hey, what's this on my paycheck now? You know, so I mean, I saw it too, and I mean, I pay it. I'm not a huge fan of it. When I think about it, yes, the property owners spend the majority of the time in this city utilizing city services. That's a duh. But people do come here to work. They utilize our roads when they are driving here to work. There is an impact there. If their place of business that they work at burns down, our fire department will be saving their lives. So they do benefit from services in that way. So I don't have a huge problem imposing that personally. We can take a look at it. Do we want to do most areas in Birmingham are at 1%? There's a 0.5, there's a 0.75 out there. So it's not like we have businesses beating down our door because we don't have an occupational tax. I think it's definitely something I'd like you guys to consider.
You talk about using the roads. We had a lady on Facebook last week. It said she thought people lived outside Irondale were tearing up our roads and wondered if we could block off our roads so non-residents could use them. Believe it or not.
Well, it's out there, and you're gonna be faced with it. You know, we had this conversation just internally here with just internally, you know, and again, nobody likes occupational tax. I didn't like it when they imposed it where my office is. But you know what, after the first month or so, I didn't think any more about it. I don't think about it except when I'm dealing with this here. But you know, one of the things would be, not only would it be, if we don't come up with revenue, not only would there be layoffs, but there will also be no raises here. No step increases here. I mean, we can't pay it if the money's not in the bank. And, you know, you take 2 years of no raises, according to these way the personnel board does these step increases of 5%, that's 10 years worth of occupational tax in the first 2 years, you know, of freezing raises. So we freeze raises 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, there's people that'll be retired before they ever recoup back the amount that they would have paid.
I know we had a downturn in the economy back in 2008, and our company had to cut back, and instead of laying folks off, they cut us back 4 days a week, and I went in and worked that fifth day because the company needed to get back on their feet. And so I worked for 80% of what I was making for about 6 months there till we got back where we could bring everybody back on for 5 days a week.
So how about that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll say this. You know, I've been working at a company 20 plus years, and, you know, there was a time where we didn't get a raise. So, I mean, but at the same time, we had a job.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And, you know, you heard a few rumblings about not getting a raise, but would you rather not get a raise, or would you rather not have a job?
Yeah.
So, and I mentioned, and everybody knows it, I mentioned occupational tax even before we started talking about property tax. Y'all know that.
Yeah, you brought it up.
I've been paying occupational tax forever.
And I heard you when you said it. I just didn't want to muddy the ad valorem tax up with discussion on it. That's history now.
Yeah, it's history. Don't want to go back to that. But yeah. I just knew, as far as the way that we need to go about doing it, you know, that's important also, because as a council, yeah, we're not going to all agree on raising taxes, no matter what it is. But at the same time, it's the way we go about doing it and explaining it to the citizens and being more transparent and just things in general. But yeah, I'm just glad I got a job. Yeah. So
I worked for a bank in 08, so yeah, I completely get it. I mean, in Florida. So but yeah, and I did bring it up. I hate occupational taxes. I was looking. I don't like the idea of it. I was hoping that the residents would step up. But
I want to say this though, as a council, and I say this even about myself. You know, I think you just mentioned that we don't have businesses beat down our door. I think we can be more diligent and do our due diligence and being a little bit more aggressive and reaching out to some of these businesses or reaching out to some of these companies,
yeah,
and promoting the city of Irondale. There are some things that we have now which, you know, other municipalities don't have. And one, since we just finished talking about property tax, we have the lowest millage here in Jefferson County.
Absolutely.
We have one of the better school systems here in the United States. I think we need to do more of our due diligence as far as selling, from an economic and community development standpoint, selling the city. I think that's what's needed first.
And I'll agree with you, though, but
We have relationships.
Yeah.
And from my world, relationships matter. Okay?
Absolutely.
Relationships matter. Well, and that's what we've been lacking. So
my only thing is, and I agree fully with you, I think we need to do a better job marketing our city. We need to be more aggressive with it. But I mean, those are things that are going to take time to see results on. Whereas I don't think we have a whole lot of time to wait based on the financial situation that we're in. But I definitely agree with you from, if we can obviously bring more businesses in, that's more taxes that the businesses will pay. That's a win-win, absolutely. I just don't know from the time component. That's all I'm saying.
What I'd like to see is put together a committee. We don't need a committee. I'd like to see the cities in Irondale that have a storefront or a service to offer. I'd like to see a list of them somewhere. You know, because I don't know what every business is in Irondale, and sometimes I go outside Irondale to get a product, and you know, and they may have it here in Irondale, because we don't know all the businesses. People don't know all the businesses in Irondale, and they saw, hey, I need a product, and this business over here has that. I can go see them before I go outside of Irondale.
But see, I mean, that's all great stuff, but it costs money. You know, we could easily implement a shop local program. That's money, that's marketing, you know. It's kind of like, I mean, trust me, I'd love to put a back deck on my porch, but that's money, you know. I mean, I've gotta do some things before I can put the back porch on.
I mean, if we could, you know, if we had someone that could go through our business license in categories, put it on the website so people could go to the website when they get ready to go shopping for something and say, hey, it's out there. You got Durante down here. Anything for the outside of your house, windows, doors, decks, they put a deck on my house several years ago. Mm-hmm. Right down here on First Avenue South, Durante. How many people got the contract to come build a deck on their house, you know, not just from our deck.
Mm-hmm.
Paint store down here, you got Benjamin Moore and you got Sherwin Williams. How many people go over to the Home Depot or Lowe's over in Trustful and buy paint? Well, we got two paint stores right here in the city. People don't know, may not know they're there.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm getting at.
No, I get you.
But I like what you said. I mean, we're talking about the here and now.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about the right now.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So
like 6 months from now.
But if we could
like
get,
yesterday.
Yeah.
If we could let people know what businesses we have in Irondale,
yeah,
it would go a long way to get them to shop in Irondale before they go outside of town to look for a product that's already here.
Yeah.
These carpets were installed by a business that's in Irondale. I didn't even know about them. I didn't until Donna found them.
But I know that we're going to be staring down a budget in the next few months. I mean, it's April. We're going to be looking at that. Mm-hmm. And probably 3-4 months, we're going to open up that door. And we're going to have to start crafting projections. And it's not going to be pretty the way it is currently. So.
Are we allowed to make comments?
Yes.
First question is, when is the Irondale website, the new website, going live?
They're loading it now.
Okay, so by the end of the week?
Hopefully by tomorrow.
Okay, great. The second thing I wanted to mention is there's a lot of talk going on around Irondale. There are people that are angry, both those that supported the tax referendum, those that didn't support the tax referendum, and in their eyes, while the mayor put on a very good presentation that explained things, that word didn't get out completely, and they're blaming the city council for not presenting why there needed to be a tax referendum. They're blaming you for that.
Let me finish. Oh, okay.
I need to finish. And now you're talking about an occupational tax. And many are saying, well, let's see. If I work hard and I put my money in the bank, let's say I have an emergency fund or a CD or something for that rainy day, you think it's fair that you have to pay a tax on that? And most people will say, no, it's not fair. And it's happening. And now you're wanting to, and they're saying, that's penalizing me for trying to get ahead. And now you're wanting to penalize people that work in Irondale for trying to get ahead. You're targeting a group of people. This is not the entire community of Irondale, but you're actually targeting a group of people that work in Irondale. And that's unjust as well.
First off, to address the not getting... I can't tell you, and I know Facebook is not the only way to communicate.
Facebook.
I know, but trust me, there are a lot of people that have, because I've spent hours a day talking to them about this.
I don't know Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. There's a lot of
don't
junk.
Don't do any of those things. This
here.
Is what people
but,
are telling me.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I got zero phone calls about this. Mm-hmm. And Connie will gladly give up my phone number. I had four emails about it. I had a lot of traffic on Facebook about it, which I really tried to talk about.
Here's what they're saying, David. They're saying,
yeah,
you guys should have been in your neighborhoods going to doors, knocking on doors, explaining, this was your responsibility. You can't expect people to call you, come see you, just as any business in Irondale can't expect people to come see them just because they're in Irondale. They have to get out and market themselves. And you didn't do that. That's what they're saying. You can't sit in the city chamber and want this done without actually going and explaining to people. The mayor called some town hall meetings. That was out there, that was advertised, and that word got out, and there were people that came to these town hall meetings. But the five of you that sit on this council weren't out there explaining to people. And that's why the people are saying it failed.
Are you saying that all of us should have been for the tax referendum?
I'm saying that you should have presented why.
No, she's
why we was not for it.
Why this tax referendum?
She said that we didn't go door to door.
She said we didn't go door to door and knock on their door.
Why? To tell them why we're not for it?
No.
Either way, that's what I'm trying to get to.
Why does the city need a tax referendum? $55 million bond debt. These kinds of things. We're 25th out of 38 municipalities. We're doing 6.5 mils. These things that the mayor did. That's what I'm saying. Not saying for or against, but you're presenting the facts. And here's where we stand. And I think if people knew that, then you would have seen a different outcome. We're talking about a 90 vote differential.
Well, I think the people
90
spoke.
Votes.
Personally, I think
I think you're onto it. That was the problem. I don't think Facebook was the problem. I don't think of that. I think the council was not unanimous in it. I mean, it's clear. It's clear from the comments here.
Yeah.
Councilman Beard said from the beginning.
Right.
I will vote. He said, I will vote. Well, let me finish.
Oh, I'm sorry.
He said, I will vote to put it on as a referendum, but I'm not in favor of it. You're clearly not in favor of it. One other councilor.
I was not.
One, I said you're clearly not.
Yeah.
One other counselor went on TV and said, you know, 2 weeks before it happened, I've got questions about it. Well, you've got three of your council members who are not even supporting the tax referendum. You got two who were publicly. I heard two counselors publicly do it. That's fine. You all have a right to express your opinion on it, but that's why it didn't pass. It wasn't because of Facebook. It wasn't because of you know, I don't know what it's going to be used for, that sort of thing. I mean, those are all parts of reasons. But the real reason why the other 90 votes didn't come is because the council was not unanimous in support of it.
There was only five votes, though. This was a public referendum that the people voted for. Okay,
right. That's what I'm saying.
So the people.
So I'm saying, if the council had been united. If three of you can't get 90 votes, you don't need to be elected. If you can't sway 30 people in this city to support something, then we've got a problem. You know, we've got a leadership problem.
Well, no. Let me say this: you can have someone that you elect to hold a position, but during that term, 90% of my people probably will not agree with everything that I say.
Indeed.
Okay? Indeed. So that's the difference. They can vote a person into, I'll use myself for an example, they can vote me into office, but if there's a certain referendum or a topic that comes up that they don't agree with and I feel differently about it, I can't tell them to vote for it, even though they voted for me to be elected to office. I agree to disagree with them because they may not feel the same way towards a certain referendum that I feel.
Perfect. That's a perfect example. So, but that's what leadership is. Leadership is helping move people from point A to point B to point C, not just sitting there saying, well, we just disagree, so I'm not going to do anything about it.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, you're missing the point that I was stating. I wasn't stating that you needed to get out there and say I'm for this or I'm against this. I'm stating that you needed to get out there and state what he said. We've got a $55 million debt. We've got this much of a deficit coming up. We only have this much in reserves. Give people the information and let them decide based on the information that you've given them so they are informed. They were not informed. They kept seeing nonsense on social media, which were complete distortions, and therefore they based on that outright fake news. That's all I'm saying. I'm saying you needed to get out there and present the facts. Not saying I'm for it or against it, but give people the facts. If people are intelligent enough to make a decision based on the facts that they receive. That's all I'm saying.
I never once told someone how they should vote, but I did try to paint the picture of why we have a referendum, why we need this referendum. I saw you do it. You did it. You put it out there. I don't think you told anybody how to vote, but you told them why we needed it. And then there was others that didn't feel like we needed it, apparently.
Hal, do you want to say something?
No, just if you inform everybody of the whole story, then they can make an informed decision. But without the right information, they're just blowing in the wind.
Right. There's a lot of people don't get the right information.
Well, you know,
well good, let's give them the right information.
That even when the information is out there, even though the information is presented, they're still misinformed because the information that you put out there probably still is not accurate. So I don't agree with that either. There are a lot of information that's put out there to the citizens that's presented as facts. That's really not true.
Then you folks have the responsibility to make sure your constituents are properly informed.
That is true.
The information was put on the website. It was put on the video. I mean, it's a responsible voter would have the ability to go out there and look for the information himself instead of just what somebody tells him on Facebook or somewhere else.
I don't listen to that crap.
Councilor Bearden, when you run for re-election, do you post stuff on the internet and expect people to know about your positions? Are you out there, if you have an opponent going against you, out there telling people why? Here's what I've done. Or are you expecting social media to do that for you? No, you're out there among your constituents, informing them, letting them know, so they can make an informed vote. And that's all I'm saying.
My question,
that was not done.
My question is, how do you think we should do that? We should knock on every door in the city?
Well,
I'm saying call some meetings in your...
Yeah, I believe what she's saying. I mean, I've been sitting here, I've been trying to keep quiet, but I can't keep quiet.
Jump in there.
But at some point in time, if all of us are in the same boat, we can't be rowing in different directions. Because if we row in different directions, we'll never get to where we need to be. Therefore, if we were not going to have where everybody was going to fully be behind it, we never should have had it, because it did give the appearance of that we have a fractured leadership group that do not want to move the city forward. And sometimes you have to put your own... Politics is about compromise. So sometimes you have to give up your own beliefs for the group as a whole. And going forward, I hope we will embrace that concept. Is I may not believe everything or be behind it, or it may not even be something that I want to do. Occupational tax. I mean, I work in the city. I don't really want us to have it, but I'm willing to pay it. And I think that's where we got to get to the mindset to say, it's not about me, it's about the city. And if it's beneficial for the city, because the house is burning down. Basically, the house is burning down. And we got water, and we won't throw the water on there because of our beliefs. So we got to move beyond this, and that's what this has shown. I mean, I've heard the same thing that Cindy said. I mean, I stood out there for most of the election. I mean, we had about 300 people to show up to the town hall meetings, but 1,400 people came to vote. So the other 1,100 people wasn't informed. I even had one person, and this is my funny story right here. They came up, they spoke to me as they were going in. They came out, and they said, I voted against it. Can you tell me what it's really about?
Yeah.
And then once I told them what it was really about, what we were going through, why we wanted to do it, how we wanted to continue to provide the city with service and all that, they said, man, I wish I would have asked you that before I went in to vote. Mm-hmm. So...
No, you're exactly right. Fractured leadership or no leadership, I mean, whichever way you want to term it. But we were not, to use your analogy, this council was not rowing together. And that's, in my opinion, that's why the thing failed. I mean, it's remarkable, a tax is hard to pass anyway. It's remarkable that we came within 90 votes of approving this tax with three of the council members openly saying they're not in favor of it. I mean, why would your people want to follow you if you're not in favor of it? You know, so for two councilors to carry, for two councilors to carry it within 90 votes.
You know, what's that?
They would want to follow because, number one, based on their own opinion.
Well, what facts?
You know, based on their own opinion. Number two, they would want to follow because of some things that they may not have agreed upon. You know, upon which they heard probably from the town hall meeting. You know, I don't know.
You weren't here. You weren't here at the town hall meeting.
I don't know.
We took a vote and it's.
No, I had to work.
Well, I.
No, I had to work. And even though me not being here, let me say this, even the date was set, that's another thing. We're talking about leadership. When we set these dates, when we make these dates, I've never been a part of a group.
We didn't ask you.
Right, I've never been a part of a group who set dates and set times without a consensus, without going to the council and saying, okay, what's convenient?
And it's unfortunate.
I've always gotten emails.
It's unfortunate that you're just going both of them.
I think we've had enough discussion on that, but I have a motion to adjourn.
All right, second.
All in favor?
All right.
All right.